This is a video of our trip up the La Plata River Canyon on July 2nd, 2014. We left from Durango as part of the Jeep tour done by Mild and Wild, and the first thing you do is drive out Highway 160 west towards Hesperus. And along the way, they were doing some construction. Check out the worker here who's smoking a cigarette. It's one of the few jobs in the world where you can smoke on the job. So we got up and turned at the Kennebec restaurant, headed north along the La Plata River Canyon. This is a view of where we're going. It's paved here. Some nice shots. We're coming on into the town of Mayday. Here's the school of Mayday. There were three towns up here, and Mayday is the only one that kind of still exists. Parrot City was out where the Kennebec restaurant is now, right on Highway 160 and the intersection of the road to Mayday. And then this is the, then there's Mayday itself about 4 or 5 miles up the road. And then further up was La Plata City, which we'll see a little bit excerpts of. So we start up the gravel part of the road, and we can kind of see it's have a beautiful smell. We stopped at Bedrock Creek, and there's our guide. He's explaining about gold mining, and he showed us some nuggets of rocks that could possibly have contained gold. Here's Donna and Dean in front of the waterfalls. That was coming down there was really kind of pretty. Here's Andrew and Dean. Then we got back on the road and headed up the road towards, this is the site where the town of La Plata City was. And now we're, this is the view of the Jeep that was riding behind us. And we're still on the gravel part of the road. It really wasn't too rough here. Stopped for a little bit, and we were looking at something, and these are people who have carved their initials in this tree. And just a little further up is the site where our guide told us was a boarding house for the miners, and all that's remaining now is this chimney. But this is a very distinctive chimney. It's right next to the road, and you know you're entering the rough part of the road when you see that chimney. Donna's taking a look at something off in the distance. Here's a view down. That's what the La Plata River looks like at this elevation. But this whole area is its canyon and valley. There's another shot of the river coming down from the pass. Here's a marmot who was hanging out by the edge of the road, and here's another shot of the same guy. Then these are mining tailings, and they're in the very center of this picture. There's actually kind of a loading dock thing that was used to bring the ore out from the mines. But this whole area is just full of silver and gold mines, and it was active even as late as the 1930s. This is a beautiful little place in the river where there's a kind of a wall in the center, lower center of the picture, which our guide told us the river used to come across there. But just to the right of it, you'll see those downed trees, but avalanches came down during the winter and actually altered the course of the river. The river now goes a little bit to the right, but it used to go across that sort of wall and kind of a veil falls there, but the huge force of the avalanche caused the logs to sort of change the course of the river. And these are some shots of the beauty of the mountains that you see as you go up the road. Now we're getting close to a little turn near where I got as far as this point on my bicycle once a couple years ago. And this is a waterfall coming down and cascading down from the top there. Here we are at the turn that leads to Columbia Basin on the right, and then take the left fork, you head towards Kennebec Pass, Forest Road 571. A close-up of the same sign. Some views of the beauty of the area. Now we're climbing up for a little bit further. That's what these shots show. Here's some other. This is Cumberland Mountain, which we start to see at altitudes over about 10,500 feet. A lot of different views of Cumberland Mountain because the road keeps going through switchbacks and you see the same mountain. Now we've come to a flat place in the mountain. We're very close to the top, and this is an area where there was a processing mill for ore, and this is that machine that's a remnants of a machine that was used for putting, I think it sucked air down into the mine or something. You can sort of see the scale of it, see the people off to the left there. Here's a close-up of the same thing. And this is some shots of the kind of panoramic views that you get up here. That's looking back a little bit towards the south. And then some other shots of the mountains that are around us. Here's another one of Cumberland Mountain. Now we've reached the top of Kennebec Pass, and this is the road intersects the Colorado Trail, and this is looking where the trail goes north. You can see it's 1 mile to Taylor Lake, but 450 miles to Denver. If you walk the other way on the trail for about 25 miles, you come to Durango. These are some people we didn't know, but it was kind of a cool shot. They're just walking around picking things. Some views of the flowers. It's just filled with. That's the Colorado Trail. That's the same sign you saw earlier. That's kind of headed off in a northwesterly direction, which is how the trail gets up towards Molas Pass and Molas Lake, and then eventually angles on towards Denver. Here's a video I took of the pass itself. People are standing at the information signs, and we're looking off to the northwest here. You can climb up to that little hill and get a little bit better view. But off to the north, you get an absolutely fantastic view of the mountain ranges. It's a little bit of a hazy day, so it didn't come out too well on this video, but this gives you a sense of how it looks. My still pictures were able to capture it a little bit better, as we'll see. And now we're headed off and looking more towards the south, but it's mostly east. This is where the Colorado Trail leads towards the pass. Here are my traveling companions, Donna, Dean, and Andrew. Some other shots of them. You can see the mountains off in the distance. And here are the four of us taken by a bystander. Had a little trouble with my viewfinder. That looks a little better. Notice my hair is very windblown because we were sitting in the back of an open truck all the way up. These information signs explain the pass from different perspectives. And as you can see here, the area where the La Plata River Canyon is was originally Ute Reservation area. And then the miners came in the 1860s. They were actually trespassing on land owned by the Utes. And it was to defend them that partially them and ranchers that were a little bit further south, that the military Fort Lewis was established in 1870. Here's some flowers that are on the along the way, some close-ups of how they looked in the fields. Other shots of the flowers. Here's another. That's a nice one with the trees in the background. This explains a little bit about the towns of Parrot City, Mayday, and La Plata City, where the miners lived. Notice they were mostly active from 1874 to 1883. But that woman on the left there, Olga Little, worked it as late as the 1920s and the 30s and packed supplies up to the Plata Mountains. And she also packed ore out, you'll notice, for the cost of, for a fee of $20 per ton. It gives you photographs of where there were a lot of people that lived in this canyon up until the 30s. And this gives a little description of the flora and fauna. And if you were standing at the sign, you could look up and see the various mountains in the distance, including Engineer Mountain, north of Durango Mountain Resort, and Potato Hill, just to the right of it, which is where the highway goes up between those two mountains, Highway 550 to Silverton. But the view is you could pick out the mountains from this site. And there's the view. In the middle is, you can see Engineer Mountain. It's a little hard to identify every peak from this particular photograph. It was a little bit of a hazy day, but you still get a sense of how spectacular the view is from up here, pretty much looking straight north. And this is looking east. You can see the Colorado Trail heading up, and then just a little bit to the right on the skyline, you can see the notch that the trail goes through, and then it goes down a couple of pretty steep route, and then it eventually meets Junction Creek Road after about 2.5 miles. So we're not very far from an area that you can drive to coming up to Durango from the other side, leaving from 25th Street. This is a shot of the vehicles that we took up, the Mile to Wild. They had two flatbed trucks with those seats in the back that where we sat. Here we are again, same view of the same trucks. This is a view from the mountains looking south. And now we're looking a little bit away from the trail, and you can see where the information signs are and get a sense of the close-up and also the distance. This is another video that's showing the pass. There's the Colorado Trail. Now we'll swing around and we're looking. There's Cumberland Mountain, and we swing around a little bit further, now looking south. There's the road that we're about to take back, and actually a vehicle is approaching. And now we're looking west. That's where the Colorado Trail takes off towards Denver. One of our guides is going to tell the story of how this woman north of here got killed by a bear because she was foolishly feeding them.
That she would feed black bears under. And she would get these congregations of black bears coming to her house, and she'd be feeding them through this slot under her fence. And the Forest Service warned her multiple times not to do it. You heard the story.
This is not good news. It
No.
doesn't have a good ending, does it?
No. Just like with people and with dogs, bears have different personalities. Trust me, I've worked with enough of them to see they're just like dogs. I've had the same breed of dog three different times, and they couldn't be three more different personalities. Well, every now and then you find a psycho bear. Some psycho bear kind of detected weakness in this frail old woman and grabbed her, pulled her under the fence, and pulled her head off.
Oh,
And then
lovely
the,
story.
yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I just had to tell them about the recent murder in Silverton too.
I didn't
hear.
First murder in 30 years in Silverton.
Really?
Now we're getting ready to go back. There's a vehicle that's leaving from going down the road. We're looking south there. There's some last views of the Colorado Trail looking to the east. Same thing. There's another sign that I realized just now that I didn't read. And there's the view looking north with the flowers in front of it. It's just spectacular up there. Here we are, all loaded up in our vehicle, ready to go on back. See how we sit? in an area that's really nice when you're going about 10, 12 miles an hour down that forest road at the, or maybe even slower than that, because you can see up and around. It's not so pleasant on the highway, however, when you're traveling 55 miles or 60 miles an hour. Now we're starting down. Here's some views of the trip back. We saw a deer, which you can see in the lower center of this picture. He kind of was looking at us. We got a couple of shots of that deer. And now we're seeing views of Cumberland Mountain. There's the other truck in front of us as we're going down. We met some bicyclists, some cyclists coming up on their mountain bikes. It's a pretty rough ride all the way from wherever they started. Probably, they could possibly started in Durango, but it's more likely that they started at Mayday. We stopped and Dean had me take some pictures of these wild roses. So we got some nice close-up shots of wild roses here. Here's the third one. Another one. Still another one. And on the way back, we were driving at about 60 miles an hour, and I swung my camera over and took this picture of Donna. This was pretty tough. We had a lot of wind blowing at us sitting in the back of those trucks.